All right, how has everybody been doing? It's great to see you. And I am so pleased that so many of you have joined us again today on this call. Let's kick it off with some situation update. We have positive cases that total in Oklahoma, 5,532. There have been 299 deaths. And currently we have 159 hospitalized with 746 discharged. Oklahoma's numbers continue to be positive and moving in the right direction for the state to continue in phase two of the reopening plan and possibly into phase three in a few more weeks. Transportation and school buses. We know and recognize that figuring out how to bus our students to school in the fall is going to be one of the greatest challenges for the schools. While the ideal way to do that is to separate students with at least one empty seat between them and in staggering rows, we know that for most districts, this is simply not feasible. Districts could also consider staggering transportation times and routes to reduce the numbers of students on a bus at the same time. But for some, that's not feasible either. There's also the suggestion to bring different students into the school on different days, having A or a B day schedule, and that could also reduce crowding on buses and in buildings. But again, I want to underscore that we understand this is likely or may not be even possible in some of our school settings. So something that should be doable for all districts is to open bus windows whenever possible to increase the flow of fresh air to significantly reduce the likelihood of transmission. As research progresses on transmission of the virus, we know that there are far fewer cases that can be traced back to touching items where the virus might have been present. Instead, epidemiologists, including our state epidemiologist, says that cases are largely being traced back to viral particles in the air that are then inhaled by others, increasing the flow of fresh air on buses. And even in school buildings can significantly reduce transmission through the air as those particles are dispersed. So districts should communicate with families about the measures they are taking to protect student bus on their buses and also so that parents may make other arrangements if they prefer. In fact, I know that in many years while my kids were in school, the district was trying to get people to ride the bus instead of dropping children off one car at a time because families just thought that was more convenient. But maybe the same district today would actually be changing that request and leaving the buses for those who absolutely have no other way. So that's just some food for thought. As you communicate with families about the measures you are taking to protect their students on buses, it will help parents as they make the arrangements that they prefer or that they must have and need. Encourage families who can drive their students, as I just mentioned, to school to do so to create space for those who cannot. Also, I think it's a good idea to direct our siblings to sit together on buses to make space for others. And also ask middle and high school students to wear masks to decrease the distance between them to allow for space to separate younger students who are unlikely to wear those masks successfully. If a district would like to use their CARES Act funds to purchase additional buses, that is allowable. And Monty, would you be on the call right now at this time to explain a little bit more about that?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay.
We're just working on our application process and trying to stay consistent with that application process. So we feel very comfortable with approving the purchase of buses to promote social distancing. And you could also put in there to promote social distancing and enhance your abilities to promote distance learning. So those two things that could be rolled into the application, and it would give you a dual purpose for purchasing that bus. And we just feel like in future times when the USDE asks us how we allocated those funds and used them, that would be a very good process for us to use and very good justification for putting that money into those places.
And that's a deliverable you have long after this virus is behind us. And the other thing, Monty, you mentioned you had some quotes on what it would take to put hotspot, to have buses with Wi-Fi for the community, or at least while you're on the bus. Any comment there?
I've been, not giving plugs or anything, I've been working with some of the bus salespeople and trying to get in touch with their suppliers. And for as little as $1,000, you could make a bus into a hotspot. And for more in the $2,000 range, it could have actually service multiple servers, services. So there are some really good options out there that you could use. And it wouldn't have to be a bus. I know I've been at a few schools that had less than desirable service vehicles that could be placed throughout the district to use. There are some of these devices that are mobile as well. So it wouldn't necessarily have to be a bus to be able to create a hotspot somewhere in your district.
Excellent. And I see also that Renette Tippins made the point that we made just now about trying to somehow put social distancing onto buses is just absolutely impractical. And also the idea of an A or B schedule on days is something that is very unlikely to be used in many districts in Oklahoma. I doubt we see that used very often, but it certainly is an option. And thank you, Monty, for highlighting just some other ways we can use our buses with our CARES fund and have deliverables in the future. And then it looks like somebody was asking, can you point them in a direction to have anything that perhaps, you know, where they can get a hold of some of these vendors that you've been talking with?
Yes, I just went through some of bus salesmen that I've used in the past. So any of your bus salesmen can, they'll have a vendor that works with them to provide those equipment and installations for those in the buses.
Excellent. Okay, very good. Now, let's keep going here. On the reopening update plan, the CDC published its response to the president's plan for opening America up again earlier this week. It contains information that will be helpful to schools as they plan for the summer and the fall. We will put that link in the chat box as well. Also, the OSDE is continuing to work on the framework for reopening schools in the fall. It is our goal to have it out by the end of May. I think you will find it to be pretty helpful and a good tool as you are making some of your plans right now for the fall and those plans that can be tailored to fit your community. Also, child nutrition. Additionally, we are excited to announce that a number of child nutrition waivers have been extended. So I'd like to run through these quickly and then see if Jennifer can add some more information. There are four. One, waiver for meal service time flexibility, which allows schools to serve two meals at a time. That has been extended until August the 31st. Number two, waiver for non-congregate feeding, which allows the grab-and-go meals or meal delivery to students, has also been extended until August the 31st. Number three, waiver for meal pattern flexibility, which allows a waiver for certain meal components, has also been extended, but that's until June 30th. And then number four is a waiver to allow parents and guardians to pick up meals. That has been extended to August the 31st. We did go ahead and update our FAQs to reflect this information since they were sent out last week. So if you haven't had a chance to catch all of that, you can easily reference the information in the FAQs. Jennifer Weber in Child Nutrition, would you have anything more to add?
No, I really don't. They just continue to extend the meal pattern flexibility month by month. I personally feel it'll go into through July. Nothing to base that on, just completely my opinion, just based on what they've done so far. The other extension we got was to the unanticipated middle school closures, and that will allow you all to serve, if you are currently approved for at-risk, which is what you all often refer to as the third meal, which allows for a supper and a snack, that has been extended through June 30th. So if you are currently approved for at-risk, you may still continue to do a supper and a snack along with maybe breakfast and lunch through SSO or SFSP also. So that's four meals that you can continue to serve through at-risk, third meal, supper and snack through June 30th. Just want to remind you as you do start to have your discussions about next school year, just to put a little bug in your ear from all the child nutrition people we hear from on our biweekly call, they would like to be involved in those conversations. Sometimes they're kind of a last minute thought and say, here's what we want to do, now go make it work for us and feeding the kids. So if you could, you guys could maybe keep them in mind when you're making those plans, they would really appreciate that. But we are full force with summer feeding and SSO, and we hope that you guys are still having luck and that your participation's up, and we hope that you are still continuing to feed as much as you possibly can in your community. Does anyone have any specific questions?
We can go ahead and move forward, and we may come back to you, Jennifer, as questions come up.
Sounds good. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Jennifer. Finally, before we open it up for questions, we are hoping in one of our district all-call weekly visits with you to have Dr. Erin Wendell-Bow, who is the state's interim epidemiologist. He is willing, and we are very excited for him to be able to just field your questions. Our team was on a call with him and just found it to be one of the most helpful calls we have had in a long time. So we were excited that he was going to be willing to do that. We will get that date for you. We have a little bit more time that we're going to need to give with, I know COSA has their conference next week, so we won't have this call, and that way we'll be working to get with Dr. Wendell-Bow, again, a public school parent right here, going through everything your families are also going through, understanding a lot of the decisions that you're trying to make right now in anticipation for how to keep staff and students safer in the schoolhouse. So that's upcoming, and we'll get that date for you. But I would like to ask you to also think about in the foreseeable future, if these calls are helpful and if you want to continue them. We are more than happy to do that. We're going to continue to put out guidance, sometimes clarifying some of those items are often the topic of conversation on this call. So if it is helpful, then we're happy to continue that. But I would like to ask you, do you want to stop or resume these closer to the very beginning of school? Or shall we kind of take it maybe a little bit, extend it a little more? Okay, so we're hearing from some of you that you think these calls are helpful. Okay, well then that's good.
Hey, and Superintendent, just a quick correction. I think the COSA conference is in 2 weeks. So next week, this call would happen on Wednesday, and then the following week is the COSA conference.
Okay, I gotcha. And I think Phil Bacharach had, he's the one who initiated this idea, thought it was great, and already had the ability to get Dr. Wendell-Bow in, but it was during the COSA conference. So we wouldn't have a time with this call as we assume most of you will be involved in the COSA conference, which will be really very exciting to do all this online. So we will pick up a time and watch your email boxes for that announcement with Dr. Wendelboe. All right, so please do let us answer any questions or make clarifications that you have. I appreciate so much what you're doing, and we want to use your questions and comments to help guide our next steps as we prepare for additional information.
Okay, ready for a question, Superintendent? Okay, we've gotten a couple of questions. I believe these pertain to the incentive grants and the notice in the LEA application that those would be coming. Question about when the state pricing for LMS or CMS platforms will be available and what state contracts exist for purchase. And maybe Brad may want to jump in here as well.
Yep, let's do that. Brad, go ahead.
Sure, Superintendent. I think these are rightly characterized as ongoing conversations that we are having with a few stakeholders and central purchasing here at the state level to negotiate the lowest possible contracted price and make those available to anyone, quite frankly, whether it's a school district or the agency or another agency. And so those conversations are in place. I don't have an answer as to when exactly that will all be available or what all would be available. But at this time, they are ongoing conversations that we are having and working through, so.
Our details will be in our plan as well. What we will be purchasing for the whole state. And then you will also have the ability to, of course, have access to the state rate for other tools or, you know, learning management systems or content management systems that you want to augment or add on or continue using but at a better rate.
Okay, next question.
Yeah.
Does the department or the state have an approved vendor list for hotspots or a state contract for hotspots?
We are working on that at a state opportunity, Carolyn. Phil, I think Robin, some of you, Brad, have been working on that. Who would like to help answer that?
This is Carolyn. I think we have identified a vendor that would offer those hotspots relatively cheap. I think that there's some interest at the state level in putting some money toward that. And so that is what is currently trying to be decided as far as what additional support the state could give to an effort like that from some of the other CARES Act funds that are available to the state. Superintendent, you might just describe a little bit more what people can expect in the framework that we've been working on, what types of information might be included in that, and what can districts be expecting as to receive as a result of that document?
Sure. I tell you what, hold on just one second. Okay. Just some basics as part of the framework would be different categories touching on school operations. Of course, when we think about public health, our school meal programs, all that goes with that, the transportation, etc. Also thinking about whole child supports, and that includes really the full a very broad topic that we think about the mental health, social emotional aspects of that, and a lot that will fall in that area. Growth, well-rounded academics, and within that, we think about the opportunity for them, for our students to have a use of an online tool that districts could have for free that is individualized with a real focus on marking where grade level would be for the end of that year, and having our schools, that student, individualized path, which will help them based on the way they answer their beginning questions of the curriculum, really tailoring that so that it's identifying where weaknesses are, and closing those learning gaps and moving more swiftly over the areas that are already well established or mastered. And in doing that, it's extremely individualized. So that is part of what we're wanting to do at the state level for both math and reading K through 12. This opportunity is available, not mandated, but will be available for all of our districts. And that is a part of a product that is part of a contract that's existing in the state that we would want to use our CARES Act funds to help buy, and in that regard, provide an opportunity if districts don't already have a tool that they're wanting to use. That's one example. Then there is the attention to school personnel, which is another category, and a lot of the areas that I think we can all identify are needing to be answered or offered some suggestions and considerations. An entire area around distance learning and versatile, you know, delivery models, adaptive staffing models, flexible calendars, etc. And then also that finance or some timelines and support that would also be important to highlight and share out. But the health and safety component, I think, is probably what is top of mind for most of you. And again, these are a basic framework, organizing that, and then adding to that and updating that as we continue to move through the summer into the fall, and as the data and science tell us more about what is effective and what is working for students.
I think that's really helpful, Superintendent. And to follow up on that, we've got a couple of questions along those lines. The first, maybe you or Phil might be able to jump in, but we've had some questions about securing PPE, personal protective equipment, also, you know, hand sanitizer, other sorts of disinfecting supplies. Are there any efforts at the state level to help districts with that?
Phil, would you like to try to address that?
Yeah, all I can say in the short term, at least over the summer, Office of Emergency Management has worked with Michael Ann Uten in our office with regard to providing PPE, that being masks and gloves, not hand sanitizer and disinfectant wipes. We have been in contact with Secretary Rogers and others in the governor's administration about what measures we might be able to collaborate on that would be able to help provide those to districts. We know, obviously, districts like the nation and like the world are competing for getting some of these items which are in short supply. So we stay tuned. We are working on that.
Okay, the next kind of group of questions is about virtual days and incorporating those into a school calendar, exactly how districts should approach that when they're creating their calendars for the fall. Someone from our team want to jump in on that?
Yes, and we know this is a very real need. And this is something that we want to provide an opportunity that is supported in statute and in rules, if needed, to get over any hurdles that are there, and we're exploring that. Brad, would you want to share some thoughts on this?
Yeah, of course, and appreciate that. obviously a very real need, as you said, as well as a large and comprehensive topic to be addressed that we anticipate will be fully addressed in the guidance that we've been discussing. Have seen the questions in the chat today, have been receiving the questions. One in particular is about, will these days, if districts choose to offer them, can they or will they count as instructional days for purposes of funding, attendance, and so on? The short answer is yes. We believe that they can. A lot of this is going to be governed, particularly with attendance, and that's set out in the FAQs. A lot of that aspect is going to be governed by local attendance policies on virtual days. We have an example in the FAQs on that, but again, to return to that initial question, can they count as instructional days? We believe the answer is yes. Strongly encourage districts to have policies around the virtual programs that they already have or will be setting up. We're happy to work with each district or group of districts, however that best works for you all. I saw an earlier question about the April 2019 guidance document that we put out. That is still a relevant document in a lot of respects. Some of this, we've taken the opportunity to review and revise it. I do see it that way as an opportunity where we've gone in and elaborated much more on certain aspects. Some central tenets of that are still in place. For example, should have a district policy in place regarding how these days will be implemented so that you can communicate as much as possible whether this day is going to be planned or if it comes up during a period of intermittent closure, and how to communicate with parents so that the expectations are there. Have attendance policies in place around this. One area that revisited is there is language in current statute that you can interpret, I guess, as prohibiting virtual instruction for non-resident students. But you can, in another section, offer full-time instructional services to resident students. I believe we would anticipate bringing some emergency rules around this topic to carve out and make the interpretation that that language is really applicable in a certain context and it's limited. And to revise that, it would apply going forward to any school district so that districts can not have to worry about equal protection claims, for example, about why are we only allowed to offer this full-time to certain students and not to other similarly situated students. So those are things that we are working through. I think I would at this time go to what is in the FAQs about the tenets of those policies and standards and just have the anticipation that we would be bringing rules to further alleviate some of these concerns from districts. Sorry, that was long-winded, but it's a comprehensive topic.
And Brad, is that something that you anticipate rules would be brought in May or in June?
I'm hopeful and believe right now that we would have those available for the May board meeting. And so that would, if we can do that, which I think we can, that would obviously give people more time, districts more time to make adequate plans.
Okay, ready for next questions?
Sure.
So we've got a couple more questions about technology. The first is, can we use unobligated title funds for technology? And if so, do they have to amend their plan? That may be a Monty question.
That's pretty broad. I think on Title I and Title IV, you could just do an amendment. Title II, you're probably going to look at if you want to spend it out of that for general technology, you may want to move it to Title IV or Title I first. And if you have private schools in your district transferring the Title II, you would have to consult with them. So Title II is probably the most restrictive, but the other two, yes, you could just amend your application and we would approve that. Thank you.
Okay, and then any suggestions or guidance from members of our team about requirements for web filtering and device management on hotspots or tablets? How do you manage that content? Is anybody on our call that might have suggestion for that? Maybe Aaron?
Yes, Carolyn, I'm here. We will be addressing that. I hate to continue to refer to the guidance that's coming out. That is one component that we'll be addressing, as well as device management, as well as filters. So there, like Brad said, this is such a comprehensive topic, you know, to address some of the requirements of E-rate and some of the other things, these will need to be addressed. And so to provide full guidance with that, we'll look at when the recovery guidance comes out to be able to answer that completely.
And maybe I just might add that even if you ask a question that we don't have an answer to, that certainly helps us know what needs to be answered in future calls and guidance documents. So we appreciate you continuing to send those our way. We had a couple of questions about staff members who might be in the considered in the vulnerable population or 65 and older, both questions about can districts require them to come back to the building for work if they're on a 12-month contract, and then how do districts treat them in the fall?
Carolyn, I'm happy to jump in on this one. I believe we have, I can't find them at the moment, but I believe we have addressed this in the FAQs. This is actually identified in both the current and on file executive order from the governor, as well as the hours plan that we refer to in the FAQs. I think this is a local determination, but it is strongly encouraged, not just within the executive order, the hours plan, but also at national and likely local levels as well, to make accommodations for individuals who are in those populations. That's probably the most succinct way I can answer that one. And it appears it's on page 7 of the FAQs.
Okay, we had a couple of questions about bus drivers. Monty, I don't know if we've anticipated this one. Can a district buy tires or equipment for their buses with their CARES Act funds?
That would fall under the continuing operation, so I don't see a reason why it cannot.
Okay, and then do you know if there are bus driver trainings available? Are those being held?
I know we're still working on that. We do not have those scheduled yet, but Tina, as of last week, was working on that. And there was a transportation meeting this morning that I think Ryan attended that I wasn't able to. I don't know if that came up.
Okay, we got a couple of child nutrition questions, and I think Jennifer has been responding to those in the chat, but I just wanted to throw it back to you, Jennifer, to see if anything has come up that you'd like to bring to the attention of everyone.
I did put this in the chat, but just as a friendly reminder, please go ahead and get your March, if you haven't done March, and your April claims in. We do want to pull numbers soon, but we want as many claims as there as we can to see where we stand. And I believe if I didn't answer a question, please just put it in here and let me know. And if I need to add to it, I'll be happy to.
Also, Jennifer, not everyone can see the chat. So if there's anything you think is worth, addressing for the larger group, please do
Someone did ask. Someone did ask about CEP. You can pull numbers between April 1st and June 30th. If you're considering going CEP from your direct cert list from the WAVE, please print an enrollment list for the same time frame that you pull your direct cert information. Direct cert covers most anyone on SNAP, may have a few foster children. So if you know that there's more foster children in your district, you need to reach out to your local foster agency and get a list from them. Homeless migrant runaway fall under direct certification. So would a tribal list. So if you have tribal children in your district that receive Indian commodities, please get a list from your local tribe that indicates those students in your district that receive Indian commodities. We did get a question earlier regarding the 50% free and reduced site waiver. That does expire June 30th, but I will be asking for an extension.
Jennifer, this is Mon. If you would, could you go over the timeline of what we were talking about the other day with those who have recently become unemployed and maybe applied, but there's a month's delay in getting it to us. So we would really, it may be to our benefit if we don't do that as early as we usually do.
Yes, I can do that. The information we get from the SNAP office for your direct cert information is uploaded the first Monday of every month. So we always recommend maybe pulling it by that Wednesday, which would be the first Wednesday of the month, the first Monday, because that would be the most current. And keep in mind that that runs a month behind. So a lot of schools have reached out to my area consultants saying, my SNAP numbers and direct cert numbers don't seem to have increased at all. Well, that may be because people hadn't applied for SNAP yet, or if they had, it hadn't been long enough for that information to be updated in the system and uploaded into our system. So it may be a good idea to go ahead and pull the direct cert information from the wave that first week in June after it updates on Monday, which would be the calendar, it would update, I would probably look at maybe the 3rd or the 4th of June to do that, and so that you could get the most current information, and that would be reflective of, that would be May data. So I think the longer you wait, potentially you may have more direct cert students on that list, which would benefit you for CEP if you're considering going CEP or continuing on CEP.
Okay, we did have a note here from one of our participants that they were successful in securing masks and face shields and cleaning materials from their county emergency management office. So others may want to reach out to those county offices for assistance in securing materials as well. I thought that was a good note. Maybe last question, unless folks drop additional things here in the chat box, but perhaps our favorite topic other than talking about graduation ceremonies.
Let me guess. Driver's Ed.
Yes. Can Driver's Ed begin in June?
Okay, I'm going to toss that back to you, Carolyn.
We did answer this question in our most recent round of FAQs. Yes, you can begin driver's ed in June. We would encourage you, if at all possible, to do the curriculum portion virtually or in very small groups, still continuing to try to use social distancing if possible. Yes, you can begin those courses.
And right. Carolyn is on pages 33 and 34 of the FAQs.
Okay, very good. I think maybe Superintendent, any last minute reminders while we wait for others to drop things in the chat box?
A couple of questions we haven't answered that I think one was, all on the topic of virtual days. So I saw about two or three. So one is to confirm virtual days will count as days and hours, question mark.
Yes, they can. That's the shortest answer to give on,
okay.
On the question.
And then the second one I saw we didn't quite touch on was where are the virtual attendance guidelines that could be used as a example or guidance regarding attendance?
Those are on my favorite website, which is oscn.net. It is a wonderful website to browse when you have as much time as you possibly have in life. No, I'm happy to post those. They're actually within a specific section. We link to that section in the FAQs.
Okay.
Pages 9 and 10, there's a direct link to those. But if anyone can't find them, happy to send them.
All right. So go to the FAQs and you will find a link to that precise location and statute. Then I think there was another question that I wanted to clarify that I saw about, will there be a math online curriculum or tool maybe? And just to be more exacting in my answer, yes, it is. And I mean, just to be very, very, very clear, Edmentum has a statewide contract. We are going to build that, use their statewide license rate and buy that with the CARES funds, securing that so that districts will have access to ExactPath, and that is math and reading. And again, K through 12, it's individualized instruction to mitigate learning loss that can be used all through the year, whether you're in a classroom or at home or moving between the two. It can start this summer. And again, this is one where there are different options for districts, but you can use one of the placement points that says that the goal is to be at grade level by the end of the year. And then that student, as they begin answering the first questions, that it is an adaptive, individualized plan, which will stay in park in that area where the student needs. And if needed, it's even going to go down grade levels to be where that student finds their level of mastery. And then it moves forward toward that goal of grade level work. Now, it also is a tool that is, you can set the starting point based on an alignment study and linking studies, excuse me, with NWEA MAP or with STAR Reading, so or with the STAR program. So that is also something that we know a lot of districts are using. But if it just helps you to be able to know with confidence that these are our plans, we won't be able to tell you this is happening until all of that work is done, but we're approaching the end on this. And we don't mean to be mysterious. It's just that I know we're to a place where you need to know how to plan and what to expect. And we're not quite finished with securing of that, but it would be free for the districts. And again, it's adaptive. And in that process provides some kind of diagnostic element where you're able to ascertain where a student is and how they're growing. And then teachers also have the virtual differentiation grouping that can occur for those who are using that. And they can use it in the school year in the classroom as well. Okay, so I hope that helps answer that. And
I don't know for sure, but they might have been referring to the math line item in the state budget. Okay.
And then the math line item that you heard also is talking about imagine math.
Yes, imagine math.
And that is also really a very good program. We know a lot of our districts have been using it. We have seen success with that as we study those results. We have confidence that that is worth your exploration and deploying that if that's something that you want to offer your students as well. I have a little bit of hesitance to say it's available to anyone in the state yet until we explore how far that line item can go. But that's my only hesitance in not describing it any different. Carolyn, would you have any better way to describe that for them?
No, I don't think so. I think we've got to, you know, we just received the budget ourselves, and so we've got to take some time to dig into that. Of course, there is some experience with Imagine Math in the state, so we'll be working through those details and get information out as quickly as possible.
And it is something that was funded by our department early on before we went through a lot of the economic downturn. It's not new to Oklahoma, for those who aren't familiar with it. But it is something that was a priority of the legislature, and this year they put that in the budget. And we just haven't had a chance to respond to what they did there. All right. Carolyn, as you go through, do you see anything else?
I really think that we've answered most all of these, perhaps generally, some very specifically, but unless another question pops up here at the end, I think we'll wrap it up.
All righty. Well, hey, I appreciate so much all of the really neat things you guys have done with graduation. It's been remarkable, and I've heard now that there are some who are saying, well, we got to do this next year. So I know sometimes when you get extra creative and really go out of the box and do some inventive things, you're setting a new precedence. So I think that there's some great appreciation in the community, and certainly with those seniors. I've sure enjoyed seeing fireworks at drive-in, there was such a great media pictures that we're enjoying as we get a chance to see those played out in different communities, where you're getting lots of coverage about parades and all kinds of ways to honor the students. It's really been very special and beyond what we imagined. And then those of you who are also trying to have a ceremony that is as close to normal as possible, we know you're taking a lot of time and planning to make it as safe as possible. And I sure do appreciate seeing some of your instruction to families and the way you've outlined your football field to make it as protective of students with social distancing, et cetera. So good job for that. And thank you for really doing so much more than you normally would be doing this time of year and in new ways. All right, Carolyn, are we good?
Yep, we're good. No more questions in the box.
All right, guys. Thank you so much, and have a great, great rest of the week. And we stay safe out there, and we'll be in touch. Bye-bye.